He said there was something on his heart, there was something he concerned about, which he thought was the biggest problem facing America and facing Christians in America. Now, he didn't say it was the breakdown of the family. He didn't say it was the loss of some kind of moral compass. He didn't say it was abortion or gay marriage. He said the biggest problem is that there is still not peace and reconciliation among the races. And he thought that this was the most important, the most serious thing facing America. And I know that many of his followers were very surprised by this. It's not what they expected. And I mean, one reason they were probably surprised was because it was a time of relative peace and relative harmony where, and I imagine, especially in the South, people felt like, hey, I remember when I was a kid, things have really come a long way. I think that, you know, things are pretty good now. So I think that people were a little bit surprised. And I'm afraid they probably didn't do much about it.
Of course, everybody sort of pays lip service that, yes, that's very true, Reverend Graham.
But it was not the kind of issue that at the time got people, you know, aroused. It wasn't a real polarizing issue. I imagine that if he was retiring today and said something similar, people would get right on it, and then there would be all sorts of programs and committees and things to address it. Because unfortunately, this is how things happen in our country. You know, there's a crisis, and suddenly there's a big to-do. It becomes the subject of every conference that year, and every church, and every social work organization. And after a while, it sort of disappears, as if everything's already solved, because the next sort of exciting thing comes along. And that's not what this conference is in response to. I mean, I know it just happens to be in God's providence that people have sort of awoken to the fact that relationships between the races are still problematical. There's still many unsolved dilemmas, still many questions, a lot of fear and mistrust and things like that, of course. And but that is not why we're having this conference today. And the Brotherhood of St. Moses is not a program. It's not some sort of systematic approach to fixing the social problems of the country. So, what is it? I would say that it is a sort of a different context to even look at problems, a different context to look at relationships between people in general and relationships between people that are of different ethnicities, and even a different historical context and a different spiritual context in which to look at this situation. Now, I believe that the impetus for St. Moses Brotherhood, or the Brotherhood of St. Moses, began about 22 years ago, and with Father Moses Berry, who is in Ash Grove, Missouri. And at that time, he was in St. Louis. And this, you can see his story on the website. And by the way, just as an aside, someone is making a movie of Father Moses Berry's life. And is collecting money to do this. And we'll have, you know, we have something for our bulletin to tell you about this. But this is an aside. This is, I think, a very exciting thing. But a couple things happened. For one thing, by this time, Father Moses Berry had become an Orthodox priest, and he met a lot of Christians from Africa, from Ethiopia and Eritrea, who were refugees in St. Louis at the time. And he discovered sort of a whole world of Christianity that was kind of a different flavor than what he'd seen before. I mean, if you're familiar with the worship style of people in East Africa and in Eritrea and Ethiopia, it is there is something clearly ancient about it, and something that has a kind of a piety that we don't much see anymore. I mean, we during Lent, there were some Ethiopian women that would stop by and just say, "Could I please pray in your chapel?" You know, they were spending their lunchtime praying instead of eating. It's a fast period. And one day I just happened to go up to see what, you know, to do something. I kind of forgot that there was people in there. And here were these women. They were on the floor prostrate, and just, you know, some of them were weeping, some of them were just, you know, in deep concentration, and it was very moving, you know. And they weren't doing this for anybody's benefit. This was their, how they were choosing to spend their lunch hour. And I think sometimes when people from traditional cultures look at our country, they're not sure that we really believe in God. I mean, they know we talk about God, because if you really believe in who we say God is, we are all sort of humbled to be anywhere near his presence. And we don't treat this in a casual fashion. And these were not, people were not theologians, you know. They were not nuns. They were people that cleaned houses, you know. And they, but they had such a deep piety, you know, such a deep feeling for the reality of God. So this is one thing that we learned from people from traditional cultures. And one thing we've surmised is that sometimes in places that are materially deprived, you have actually greater faith in God. How do we know this? Because it can be seen. They've done a study that showed, as the gross national product of countries develop, number of people that go to church, number of people that identify themselves as a particular religion, actually starts to fall. And what does this tell us? That it is the people that don't have a lot else to hold on to, cling to God and depend on prayer and know that their life depends on God's providence. So this is another, important lesson. Now, there are many other things. When we were in San Francisco, we had a sort of small inner city mission, and half of our congregation were people from Eritrea, and they had taken over a whole housing project. It became like an Eritrean village. And they didn't have much furniture or anything, but everything was just clean and neat as a pin. But more important than that, if there was a group of adults sitting around and a child enter in, every adult in that place kissed that child and fussed over him when he came in. It didn't matter if it was their child or not. And I remember one of our young Eritrean older boys, I saw there was a new man there, and I said, is that a member of your family? He said, I'm not sure. He said, but I think it seems like everybody's a member of our family. Because the idea was, if anybody was even slightly related to you in any way, of course they were welcomed in your home and you put them up and took care of them. So these things are part of, unfortunately, in some ways, part of another time or another place. And he also found out that, you know, they had been carrying on these traditions since before Christianity had reached many places in Europe. So this was another different context. It wasn't the context of sort of 19th century colonialism bringing Christianity to people that were already Muslim. They tried to claim in some instances, but there was Christians in Africa long before Muhammad was born. See, so this is something that people aren't taught; they don't know, and it gives sort of a different context to Christianity that is, I want to say, more acceptable, but I don't mean that in sort of a question of, this is more acceptable to my sensibilities, but really more acceptable to your soul. It's sort of some kind of connection with ancient Christianity. And I know that this has been a feature of St. Moses Brotherhood, and in fact, I think the conferences for the first many years, they were called Ancient Christianity the Ancient Christianity African American Conference. So there was a link made between ancient African Christianity and contemporary African American experience. And of course, there still are residual, some residual from, let's say, traditional African practices. One of the differences in the Ethiopian and Eritrean churches is they don't have bells, but they use drums, and the services are very long. I mean, one time we went to a wedding, and it was held at a Greek church, but it was a wedding. And I told the Greek priest that was there, the pastor of the church they were using, he was kind of estimating the time. And when the priest started talking, I said, just relax, you're going to be here for a long time. It's partly because it was a pre-literate tradition, and people didn't have written gospels. And, to sit for many hours on a Sunday and hear the word, it was a joy, but it was a nice break from working very arduously in the hot sun the rest of the week. It was a joy. And in those churches, the vestments are very colorful. It's something very exotic about it to us. But this is something that that people, it's not that we can replicate that completely, certainly. It's because it's from a different time, and I don't think people can do 7-hour services anymore. But it's something that is beautiful and something that's profound, and that's something that comes from from a traditional culture. So that is one stream. Now the other stream is, and I'm sure Deacon Turbo will talk about this today, was the reconciliation ministry that was going on in Kansas City that Father Pisces, now Father Lexi Alshaw, was running, which he was a Protestant minister at the time, and he had a place that was right on the borderline between black and white in Kansas City, and it was, clearly, the clear mission was reconciliation between the races. Now, Father Pisces became Orthodox and lost all his funding, but nonetheless stayed there and persisted, and it's still near there to this day doing wonderful work. And I won't talk too much about that because I know Deacon Turbo is here. Another stream was What I think that came to us through Dr. Al Rabiteau, who is a professor at Princeton and also an Orthodox deacon, and he wrote a book called Slave Religion. He wrote a couple of books, but his contention was that because of their suffering, you know, because of having to have held on to the faith and had nothing to trust in but God through this terrible time of suffering, that in some ways that the Africans brought to America as slaves were a kind of Christian martyrs. It was something that connected them with the very early days of Christianity, when people would suffer and die for the faith. But he wanted to show not just people that were victimized and abused, but people that were triumphant and victorious over not even, they couldn't, not over their physical surroundings per se, but over their over despair, over loss of faith, over bitterness and hate and vengeance. People that had become like shining stars in the midst of, you know, just the worst circumstances. And that this is also another stream in this African-American Christian experience. And that he also contended that if you look at American Christianity, you know, some of it is not much more than middle class hedonism. You know, it's like, Jesus loves me, and thus I have a minivan and three shining children that are enrolled in good schools because we're Christian. Said, but you know, there is a depth and profundity to the African American Christian experience, you know, which is he felt probably the most significant, the most original, and some of the deepest expression of Christianity in our country. So again, we're not saying slavery was good because it produced Christians. You know, as Christians, we never believe that it's okay to accept a primary evil because there's a secondary good, you know. Yes, it's true. The trains ran on time when Mussolini was in charge. But, you know, it's not that. It's that, you know, for Christians, when you face adversity, it is an opportunity to, you come to a crossroad where you're either going to go into despair, hate and vengeance, or you are going to be able to transform that. You'll be able to overcome those passions in yourself and rise victorious. So just in closing, as I understand, the food is 1 minute away. So that's just, you know, that is my sort of perception of the kind of streams that and the context that in which we are trying to make some kind of link between Orthodox Christianity and and the people of African descent in this country, because most Orthodox churches are pretty tribal, you know, and it would be hard to see where you fit in there if you weren't one of the tribe. So we don't think it's necessary to have one more jurisdiction, the African American jurisdiction of North America. We don't need that. It's up to people of you know, other ethnicities to get out of the way and make some room, because if we believe that this is the Church of Christ and it's for everyone, then we have to show that with our works. So thank you for coming, thank you for listening, and I think we made it just in time for our pancake. So God bless you. Yes. No, somebody else is doing that. We're very divided here. That's the night.
I'm calling audible, so if you wouldn't mind.
Okay, yes, we have. Father Jerome Sanderson is a priest from the Bulgarian diocese. You're in Brown County. What? Nashville, Indiana is where your church is? And the name of your church is?
Christ the Savior.
Christ the Savior Church in Nashville, Indiana, where he also is a wonderful iconographer. He actually created the icon of the Saints of Africa that you see in our church, and also the face of Christ behind the altar. So Father Jerome is a very talented iconographer and woodworker, and also very good at teaching the young men the songs from the old time religion. He has raised his family there in off the grid in Indiana. So if you have any questions about that, how to do that, he may be able to answer them also. This is Father Deacon Turbo Qualls from the Reconciliation Ministries in Kansas City, which I talked about a little bit. And he is a full-time staff member there.
Social worker.
And a social worker. It is, they're doing a very, a very serious, holistic approach to, you know, the problems that folks have there. So he will tell you all about that when he is ready to speak. And because we all know Basil Moses, one of our subdeacons, who has been with us for many years, right? Yes. And has suffered many indignities with great aplomb and dignity, and is a person of great integrity and great love and generosity towards our parish in many ways, known and unknown. So thank you all for coming, and enjoy your breakfast. Don't eat too many pancakes because you'll fall asleep during the talk. At least I will.
We all come here today with heavy hearts. With the events of the last week and things that have been going on in our communities for a long time. Things that have needed to change, to be addressed. And, you know, we're all trying to find an answer somewhere. And that's really what today is about, is trying to explore what answers the ancient Christian tradition has for this moment right now. So, one other thing to say before we turn it over to Basil Moses is that, you know, I think it's worth mentioning that we didn't plan this day to be a slick conference. It's not something that we wanted to provide just so that people would come and feel like, oh, well, good, I went somewhere and I heard some great talks and I feel inspired. This is supposed to be a gathering of neighbors and friends, and hopefully new friends, where we can come together and listen to each other, to talk, and really kick off an ongoing conversation that we will have to keep having for weeks and months and who knows how long ahead.
Years.
Yeah. So this is really just the beginning, and we hope to continue with you and that you'll tell your friends as we continue to have events like this and other moments to get together and just be together. And know each other. So with that, I will turn it over to Basil Moses if you'll welcome him.
Tell me if I am speaking louder. I mean, if I'm speaking, okay. I need to go up, okay. I didn't really want to hold the microphone. I am Basil Moses. I'm very grateful to be here today. Just a little background. Before Orthodox, I was actually a licensed minister at a non-denomination charismatic church, singles minister. I am totally convinced that it is through God's divine providence that I am in Orthodox Church and actually St. John Maximovich Temple in Atlanta. have a quote that I want to reference. In the sorrows that we experience is concealed the mercy of God. How the Lord arranges our life is incomprehensible for us, and that's by Saint Nikon of Optina. Starting in 1994, I was a volunteer chaplain for Georgia Department of Corrections, Phillips State Prison. And through ministry work, I met Father Chris, the chaplain there. He was desiring and looking for some help for some inmates with some various challenges, issues in the penal system. Also, eventually, I met a gentleman by the name of Chuck Ramos, who later became my godfather as a result of him supporting this prison ministry. After close work with Father Chris, he invited me to attend an Orthodox Church in San Francisco. I took him up on the offer, 2020 Steiner Street, and that was one of the first times I'd actually been in an Orthodox Church. By the way, Chuck, my future godfather, was considering converting to Orthodoxy. I was very willing and open to exploring Orthodoxy. The first time I sensed a great, just unspeakable peace. I had never been in a church smelling the incense, the icons, and just sensed this really incredible, unspeakable peace. The second time, I was in St. Pius' Monastery in Forestville, California. Father Chris told me, he says, why don't you come to the monastery and check it out and see, you know, see about it. Very profound. Little did I know, I was kind of beginning to receive a little awakening grace, so to speak. And by the way, I like visuals. This is actually a picture in the monastery many years ago. Just thought I would kind of show this. Father Tom, that's Father Tom. Father Chris, Father Samuel. If you want to pass it around, sure. So that was kind of, again, like I said, kind of experiencing a little awakening grace to the rightness and true knowledge of God. The third time was in Atlanta, St. John's. I decided I would come to St. John's one Sunday and experience divine liturgy. I knew I was home at that point. I literally knew. I knew that was it. I was home, St. John's. During the divine liturgy, I received this first visual icon of St. Moses. It's sitting right here. The priest was backwards turned, of course, to the congregation. An acolyte brought me this icon while I'm sitting. And the priest, I remember just as clear as day, the priest literally just turned and just gave me this very profound smile. So I didn't have any words at all to even express it. But yeah, this is the first icon Father Jacob gave me. And this is my first encounter with St. Moses, having the icon. I held the icon and prayed to St. Moses to show me what to do, where to go in this possible new journey. Truly identified with St. Moses, Ethiopia, with his great struggles. He became my first saint. So again, this is the icon. I have no problem. You're welcome to pass that around as well. Of course, St. Moses was a chief robber, you know, tested with great passions, lust. Also, I was black in Atlanta, embracing my ethnicity. Eventually, I began reading many books in Orthodoxy. Just a few would be, Coming Home and Becoming Orthodox by Peter Gilchrist, the Orthodox Church by Timothy Ware. Also, I was curious to read some other early fathers' writings, St. Macarius, St. John of Kronstadt, and others. As I approached my baptism, chrismation, I really truly desired to seek a really deep knowledge of the true God, a right faith in Him, desiring to live a life of faith and life of good works, and that literally is in the catechism of the Orthodox Church. Again, I experienced what I consider maybe another grace was the grace of baptism. I remember hearing the priest make his sign, the seal of the Holy Spirit, anointed my head to renew my mind and anointed my eyes so I could view holy things and see correctly, anointed mouth so I could speak the truths of God, and anointed ears so I could really listen to the deeper things of God. and of course anointed on the feet so I could walk in that right path in orthodoxy and God in his ways. I still remember the ancient chrism only because it was very fragrant and very, very unforgettable. I became a new creature in Christ in orthodoxy. The past life was reconciled in Christ. I felt very forgiven. Of course, I would welcome any steps towards the path of transformation, and of course, that theos is meaning the dying and the purification of my mind and my body so I could continue to really have that deep union with God. Of course, unwavering, I embraced the teachings of the Orthodox Church regarding fasting, confession, morality, scriptures, other sacraments, and personal sanctification. Again, the dying of that self, the body, the mind is best, or I was willing to do. Trying to be watchful and attentive to preserve my entrance or my baptism in the Orthodox Church. Of course, dying to any and everything, again, back to the profound union with God. Of course, I had to deal with embracing the sufferings, meaning even the injustices as I worked in corporate America, humility, giving of the alms to the poor that were, of course, right here in our community, and also the stillness, the peace, the quietness, so I could settle down with this new beginning. And, of course, accepting life just as it is. God was in control. I was not in control anymore. I desired, to surrender and cooperate with God. Saint Seraphim has a quote that I really like. It says, acquire the spirit of peace and 1,000 souls around you will be saved. Also, another one that I really always see, of course, in iconostasia as I am serving, and it is, without great vigilance, no other virtues can be obtained, and that's Abbot Agathon. Also, St. Seraphim of Sarov says, and he who wants more grace must prepare himself better for temptation. So those are just some quotes that I really embrace, really keep me what I feel to be my closest in connection with God. Also, another quote that I really wanted to talk about, bear with me one second, this is flipping. In godly suffering, the other world opens up. When conversion does take place, the process of revelation occurs in a very simple way. A person is in need, he suffers, and then somehow the other world opens up. The more you're in suffering and difficulties and are desperate for God, the more he is going to come to your aid, reveal who he is, and show you the way to get out. And that's, of course, the quote of Father Seraphim Rose. Okay. Orthodoxy provided me an ultimate spiritual solution as a single black man in Atlanta, in America. Each person in his own way must keep his or her mysterious link with God. In this quote later, Father John says, do not be sad when this unique feeling passes, but remember what happened. And of course, that is from the Everyday Saints, one of my favorite quotes from the Everyday Saints. When I am in life, I cannot afford to have my peace disturbed, racism included. Letting go of resentment and the experience of all encounters of race, culture, in my life's experience. Forgiving unpleasantness from others. And by the way, I'm not embracing self-pity from no one, just a personal reflection. Regardless, again, what is going on, racism, unpleasant experiences in America, I must ascend to the supernatural world through prayers and forgiveness. I'm not alone or lonely. My solitude with God. Orthodoxy provides a congruency, all the fitting together of my entire life through a loving and accepting blessed parish, community, and God, and I sense that I'm very much loved. In this body of Christ, I'm very vulnerable, transparent, producing my own authentic journey and reflection of Christ, I pray. One of my personal favorite quotes from St. Moses regarding prayer, take care of to maintain deep in your heart cognizance of your sinful state, that your prayer might be acceptable. When you occupy your mind with your sins, you do not have time to keep track of the faults of others. one of the highlights of my journey, of course, has been serving as a subdeacon. I really enjoy serving with Archbishop Dimitri. Like I said, I really like visuals. This is of his blessed memory, Father Jacob. This is a picture of me serving many years in hierarchical liturgies. Often I pray, you know, fervently, Vladika, please show me the will of God. I do pray that a lot. This is one where I was just simply showing vesting of Archbishop Dimitri at the time is a hierarchical liturgy. Serving for many years with Father Jacob was a very unspeakable joy. This is another picture. We were in a hierarchical liturgy. And I have very fond memories, and it really, just the presence of God kept me very close. This picture, to be honest, I wanted to show it because I remember serving one morning and all of us were there, and he wasn't feeling that great, but he said, I must take this picture. I must take this picture. I could be wrong, but I'm almost sure this is the last picture he took after serving with us after Divine Liturgy. So I really cherish this picture. Okay. Again, I enjoy serving. That's all I've known since I've been in St. John. But I am one heart and one mind, the partaking of the body and blood of Christ, discerning the body. St. John, it is offering me an orthodox spiritual solution for me and also many for the true faith in God. And the last quote that I have is, orthodox mission consists in giving the treasure we have and leaving the other to decide whether he will take it or not. If the other wants to join the Orthodox Church, you will never say no. Our aim is to transmit the tradition of the gospel in all its fullness, remaining free from anxiety to convert anyone. You cannot impose on anyone's freedom. You are there. You give your witness. You are a candle lighted by paschal joy. And if the other wishes to take from your flame, then of course you will not refuse him. And that's Archbishop, quote from Archbishop Anastasio of Albania. So this is the last picture I have. And like I said, I really, really enjoy visuals. And this was actually at a Pascha, at lighting of the Pascha candle. And this is actually Father Jacob when he lit this candle. So again, this quote is very profound. And I just feel like we all have a candle. And I have to, of course, be willing to offer my orthodox solution to anyone if they willingly would like it. So that is what I have. I'm very, again, very grateful to be here. And it's so interesting that, of course, we would be in Atlanta and events are occurring, but I think I'm at the right place for sure with God. So thank you.
Thank you, Basil Moses. We'll have a chance to hear more from him later as we do the panel discussion. Just to be quick, since we're kind of shorter on time, I'm going to go right over to Father Deacon Turbo. You welcome him.
So is the microphone necessary? Is it better with the microphone?
Much better.
Much better. Okay, great. For many years I was in bands, so I'm used to microphones, so it's good.
A couple things I want to say. Thank you to Cecil and to Cameron and to Ryan and to everyone else who put this on. This is fantastic. I really appreciate what Cameron had to say. Oftentimes with church stuff, everyone wants to have something kind of slick, a nice presentation. And the biggest problem with that is it gets in the way. People get too concerned about everything going smooth, which is good. You know, our God is a God of order. However, people, if you know people, aren't always orderly. So you have to give them space. So I appreciate what you had to say. Another thing I wanted to say was I'm very honored and thankful to be here. I attribute my ordination, my vocation that I currently have, the ministry I have, the wonderful life my wife and my children have enjoyed in the church, in many regards directly to the intercessions of St. John Maximovich. I've prayed many, many times in front of him at the cathedral, and he has just been present with me in my life as an Orthodox Christian. So to be here is a great honor, because this is like the first church named after St. John. So that's a fantastic thing. Brothers and sisters, I'm here to encourage you in your work establishing a chapter of the Brotherhood of St. Moses the Black. I am the dean of chapters, which means basically I'm the guy that kind of helps chapters get off the ground and move along and help inform them about what our brotherhood is about. I'm also the president of the Kansas City chapter, and I was the former president of the Southern California chapter, which that's where I'm from. I'm from California. My wife and my six kids and I moved to Kansas City about 2 years ago. And I work at Reconciliation Services, which is a social service agency, which is attached to St. Mary of Egypt Orthodox Church, Serbian Orthodox Church. We do emergency services. We have group therapy. But really what we're there for is to facilitate and manifest reconciliation. Our agency and our parish is on 31st and Troost. And Troost is the literal historical dividing line for Kansas City. So what a lot of people don't know is a lot of the housing and hypersegregation and redlining, blockbusting, which are programs that were developed to have racially restricted housing, is actually birthed out of Kansas City. So Kansas City was in many regards the kind of birthplace for this idea of hypersegregation. And so where we are at is the dividing line. And of course, hypersegregation has been done away with in a legal sense, but the ghost of it still remains. The ghost of it still remains. So this is my work daily. We serve predominantly the community east of Troost. And the way it broke down was, to the east was predominantly African American and poor, and the west was not that. So we serve predominantly that community, but what's interesting about our ministry is that it is a place where people come and find reconciliation. And what's even interesting for me is this is in many ways my life. I'd like to share something with you before we even get into everything. I feel very qualified to talk to you and anyone about racial reconciliation because, first off, I, like many African Americans, have a mixed heritage. That's just the reality. Most African Americans have some smaller or greater percentage of European and at times Native American blood. That's just a reality. And I grew up, I remember going through a mall once with my older sister, and people at times had wondered if that was like my girlfriend or if that was my sister. My sister is much more lighter skin than I. And these types of experiences taught me something. It taught me to be patient with people. This is before being a Christian. Another experience that taught me to be patient was in 1993, I was assaulted or jumped by a group of neo-Nazi skinheads at a club. And you fast forward a little bit, and I find myself hanging out with a group of people. And a gentleman who became a mentor to me in my career before I became a social worker, him and I became close friends. He started teaching me his craft, and we ended up living together. And I knew that he had a background as a neo-Nazi skinhead in the past, and we had kind of worked through that, and we can unpack that a little bit later. But there was this one point. It was like a 24-hour drive-through, like a McDonald's or something. And I'm grabbing the food, and as I'm grabbing the food, he says, "I gotta tell you something." I said, "Yeah, what's up?" He said, "Do you remember that show?" It was a band called UK Subs. He says, "Do you remember that show at this club?" It was called Checks. He says, "Do you remember that show where you got jumped by those guys?" I said, yeah, I totally remember that. And he says, "Yeah, I was one of the guys that was jumping you, that was beating on you." And so, I just paused and I said, "Thanks for letting me know." From there on, what's interesting is, and this is before me even coming to Christ in any shape or fashion, let alone Orthodoxy, What's interesting is, in that space and time, which felt like an hour, I understood I had a choice. That choice was I going to react? Was I going to sever something that was already there, meaning our friendship? And more importantly, I realized in that moment that my friend took incredible courage to say that. I chose to honor that. And in honoring that, what I found was the honor that was returned to me, not just by him, but by the surrounding community of us, was inspiring. When people caught word of that, people already knew that we were friends, and that in alone itself was an icon, if you will, of reconciliation. But when people caught word that it became obvious that I was aware of this, it began other people to think differently. There was another neo-Nazi skinhead who, months after that, ended up in the same apartment as us, kind of hanging out and partying. This is another gentleman who, probably about a year or two before that, him and I would not be sitting down and talking. We'd be talking with something else, you know? So this is an experience that I have lived. When I became a Christian, one of the first young men that I ever led to Christ was, at that time, someone who was struggling with racism. It was a well-known thing, and through circumstances, which I'll get into how that's even possible, that him and I could be talking, I had the honor of leading him to Christ, to whatever degree I was able to. Interestingly enough, 2 years ago, I received my 16th godchild. I've gotten more since then. And when I first met him many years ago, he himself was also running with racists at that time. So this isn't an isolated incident with me. It's something that I recognize as a grace of God. It's something that I've tried to learn from God, but it's something I've experienced. And the reason why this is important, my brothers and my sisters, is that I'm telling you, it's possible. It's possible for people to be reconciled. It's possible for the races to be reconciled. But the key is, you have to get past the sugar. You have to get past the naivete of what reconciliation means. The call to action that we have is very simple, but it is not easy. You see, the solution is to learn to have courage in the face of uncertainty. That is very simple, but it is not easy. The solution is to learn to acquire a spirit that can allow you to forgive. That is not easy, but it is simple to understand. The calling we have is to be disciples of Jesus Christ. That's simple, but it is not easy. It is not easy. And if you can understand the distinction between something being simple, but it not being easy, you'll go far. Because when you encounter the problems, and you will, you'll be prepared to jump those hurdles, if you will. Something we need to understand also in regards of the work of the Brotherhood is that it's a two-edged sword. As it's been mentioned by God's providence, let me tell you, when everything started kicking off this week, I just couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it. It was like 2014 all over again. You know, 2014, the Michael Brown thing happened, then right after him, Tamir Rice, and then Crawford. All these things happened. And I said, Lord, have mercy. And it wasn't lost on me, and it wasn't lost on my community back in Kansas City that I was coming here this week to talk about it. I want to encourage you with that, because God knows, right? God isn't ignorant to these things. It's not like the race issue escapes God. It's not like God doesn't care. And in fact, I would submit, at the very least for this community here, and for the very least those who have the proximity to hear about the work of the Brotherhood and the work of any Orthodox fellowship that seeks reconciliation, that this is something the Orthodox Church really needs to embrace and wrap its mind around to a greater degree. And let me talk about that a little bit more, why. The Orthodox Church, we believe, contains the fullness of the Christian faith. The biggest thing for the Brotherhood, for those of you who would participate in the chapter and those of you who would support it, the biggest thing about the Brotherhood is to be steeped in your orthodoxy. But let's unpack what that means, being steeped in orthodoxy. Brothers and sisters, orthodoxy is the experience of holy men and women living out the scriptures. You see? Orthodoxy is the experience of holy men and women breaking down the parts of the Bible that weren't underlined for you in a way that you can approach it, that it becomes applicable. Like when St. Paul says, pray without ceasing. As an evangelical youth minister and a lover of the scriptures, I had no idea what that meant. And I dare submit, and I know this because I had conversations with them, my pastors didn't either, you see? No one knew what that meant to pray without ceasing. But yet St. Paul says it. Okay, why is that pertinent? This is why it's pertinent. The things that the church teaches us are the very things and the only things that can help us get through these issues. Social services programs won't do it. Political programs won't do it. Politicians won't do it. They have good intentions, but they won't do it. Do you know why? Because racism is not just the fruit of colonialism. This is something that's been going wrong that I have to dispel for people. We want to think that. We want to think that the issues of race are due to colonialism, but brothers and sisters, it's not. If you read the scriptures, it's not. Moses and Zipporah, who remembers their story? Anyone? Right. Moses and Zipporah. Moses married an Ethiopian, and the scriptures say a Cushite. She was definitively African. Miriam and Aaron, the brother and sister of Moses, Miriam is like, why did you marry her? God becomes upset with Miriam and says, put your hand in the cloak of Moses. She puts her hand in there, she pulls it out, it's leprous white. God basically says, don't ever speak against my prophet. Right? It's interesting because you go even further down into the New Testament. So I'm a deacon. Do you know why there's a diaconate? Anybody know why? Yes, it is service, but it was a very specific service. If you read the book of Acts in the 6th chapter, I believe, and what you will find is that the Greek and the Hebrew women were complaining. Because they're saying they're getting more food than we are. Why are the Hebrew women getting more women, more food than we are? Why are we Greek widows us Gentile widows being ignored? So the apostles were like, well, we can't deal with this because we need to put our minds to the preaching of the word and the study of scripture. Appoint these faithful men. This is the origin of the diaconate, brothers and sisters. Was that there was dissension amongst the ethnos, right? Something very interesting. The Bible mentions nations as ethnos like over 300 times. Ethnicity, which is really what we should be talking about more than race, because race has more to do with the color of your skin, which that is something definitely more colonial to some degree. But ethnic issues and tensions have always been there. St. Moses the Black suffered from that as well. But in spite of all that, what's interesting is, do you see what the Holy Spirit did? The Holy Spirit instructed the church and had the men raised up, the diaconate was developed to solve the issue, okay? The same thing happened. There was a, are you guys familiar? There was a council in Constantinople in 1872 speaking about philatism. What is philatism, right? In a nutshell, philatism is when a church will establish itself based around solely and exclusively an ethnic identity. So what happened was, there was a Bulgarian community in Istanbul, and they were basically like, we're for Bulgarians, and that's it. And it was a problem. But you know, on the 10th of August, that synod said, this is wrong. This is wrong, and condemned philatism. The point I'm getting at is, if you look at the history of the church, she doesn't ignore these things like race and ethnicity, which is what we want to do sometimes. We want to stay comfortable. We don't want to deal with these things. But we have to, because we're called to be more than conquerors. We're called to be more than conquerors. I want to speak a little bit more about how we can do this. Okay. The first thing that you have to have is courage. We can't do a single thing without courage. And you know what's interesting about courage? If you read the book of Revelation, the Lord gives this litany of sins that are committed of people who will not inherit the kingdom. Crazy things like sorcery and adultery and all kinds of these sins. But you know like what number one is that the Lord mentions? He says, the cowardly will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. Whoa. But if you're a fan of the lives of the saints like I am, you know what you find? Men, women, and children over and over and over again with courage, going before their torturers, going before those who hated them. And in fact, what they're doing is they're following the example of our Lord Jesus. Our Lord Jesus had the courage to not even open his mouth at times. But he did open his mouth when he needed it to, right? And I think this is a clear teaching that we have to have courage. It says in the Wisdom of Solomon, for wickedness is a cowardly thing, condemned by its own testimony. Distressed by conscience, it has always exaggerated the difficulties. For fear is nothing but surrender of the helps that come from reason. When you are afraid, you can't hear the person speaking to you. You're filtering everything that they're saying through a lens of like, fight or flight, fight or flight. If you can't hear the person in front of you, you're gonna even have a harder time hearing from God. This is why when it says, we have not been given over to a spirit of fear, but of adoption, right? You know the scripture. See, this is super important because courage, if you see any work that has been done in regards of racial reconciliation, it always starts with courage. Someone had to have the courage to listen. Someone had to have the courage to be vulnerable and start speaking. And that two-edged sword that I was talking about is this. There are many within the Orthodox Church, understandably, who are scared. They have had zero contact with any African Americans. They have had zero contact or context for some of the experiences of African Americans. And they're scared. And so, one of the things that I learned, one of the things that God gave me and I've learned from, is to not be scared. let me unpack that just a little bit. Do I get anxiety? Do I feel, of course, I'm not some like superhero, even though my name's Turbo. I'm not a superhero. Courage is not something, it's not a feeling, brothers and sisters. Courage is action. You can be scared to death and still be courageous. Do you follow what I'm saying? You have to have the courage to enter into that space to listen to people. My work every day, day in and day out, is speaking and dealing and trying to be with people who have gone through incredible trauma. Incredible trauma. Some people would faint if they heard some of the stories I hear. Sometimes I want to faint from the things I hear. I can't enter in and be there for them if I don't have the courage to listen. You have to have the courage to listen. St. Siloam the Athenite said, we must always remember that the Lord sees us wrestling with the enemy, and so we must never be afraid. Never be afraid. Once you get that around, once you wrap your mind around that, you can enter into this space of forgiveness. And I'm not going to go at length about forgiveness, but I would just say, if you think about our Father, in our tradition, we say, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Some traditions say, you know, forgive us our trespasses, but I like debts, and let me tell you why. Because this unpacks a deep, deep, deep teaching that the Orthodox Church has. I won't say that our church has it exclusively. I'm sure somewhere someone expounds on it, but I have yet to find a place that goes to that depth about being indebted to everyone. Dostoevsky and the Brothers Karamazov, there's that great character, the Elder Zosima, and he talks about being guilty before all men. That sounds crazy to us as Americans. But you know what's interesting? Dostoevsky, through the Elder Zosima, was just unpacking a deep understanding, a deep Orthodox understanding, which is this. Profound, radical forgiveness. This is why the work of the Brotherhood, which is to be steeped in the Orthodox tradition, so that we can be equipped to do the work of reconciliation, is imperative. Because these deep understandings, let me back up. Think of the faith like this. The Christian faith is like a mine, which no one has dug into yet. Are you following me? You know that there's precious jewels down there. You know it. But good Lord, there's like hundreds and hundreds of feet of rock. Orthodoxy is you coming up from behind someone who's already gone before you and dug. And there was someone already before them who dug, you see? This is why one of the biggest things for those of you who are new to the faith, I want to encourage you with something, and especially the Brotherhood, it's important that you guys sharpen each other through the reading of contemporary elders. That is the passing of tradition. Father mentioned this during the homily. The thing that people don't get initially in Orthodoxy, and this is what stumbles them when they start hitting about 2 years, and you start seeing their attendance fall off, because you have to dig deep. The good news is people have dug deep already for you, but you need to come up from behind them. When you read Elder Sofroni, right? Elder Sofroni during World War II understood despair in a way that we understand despair as modern people. You know that creeping depression you feel when you're on Facebook for like 4 hours? Right. Right. This is the despair of modern man, right? And Elder Sofroni understood this. So when you read Elder Sofroni, it resonates. Well, guess what? Elder Sofroni got his tradition from St. Siloam. You see, and go back and back and back. Do not make the mistake of not communing with the elders and the contemporary saints. Do not make the mistake of ignoring them. because it is through them that you're going to be able to understand Chrysostom. Very few people have I met that can understand Chrysostom and Maximus. They go to school, oh yes, they've gone to seminary, they've done all this and that, but you know what? If you're reading Maximus and you're not praying and you're not loving your brother, you don't read Maximus. You haven't read him. If you were talking about John Chrysostom, but your heart doesn't break when you see what our country's going through, you haven't read him. Orthodoxy is lived experience. And it's a lived experience in communion with the saints. When you come together for your brotherhood meetings, remember that. Bring fresh to your mind the things that, God willing, you've been meditating on that week, so that you can sharpen each other, so that you can dig deeper into the mind together. Because it's in the deep, deep, deep minds of the faith that the tools that are going to help you as a community to heal the racial issues is going to, that's where it's going to come from. It's going to come from the communion at the cup. The communion at the cup is going to bring you to a place of communion with others. Everything flows out from that altar. When you understand that, then you don't just end up reading these books for head knowledge. It becomes heart knowledge. And brothers and sisters, I'm telling you, this isn't just flowery words. This is my living experience. This is my living experience. I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. And so can you. But you gotta put the work in. You gotta put the work in. I don't know how much time I got. I wanted to cut it short because we gotta talk. I wanna leave you with a thought about something. It says in 1 Peter chapter 2, this is kind of like my charge for you guys to think about. It says, honor all men. This is 1 Peter chapter 2. Honor all men. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. And honor the king. I believe that's verse 6. If you can learn to love all men, if you can learn to venerate each human being as an icon of Christ, you will have the most profound experiences. You will actually be entertaining angels, and you'll be actually at times, God willing, entertaining the Lord himself. But you have to have the courage to honor those who come before you who may smell bad. They may not look like you. They may have a mental illness. They may just be traumatized. You've got to get past that. You have to have the courage in order to honor all men. Once you've honored all men, it says, love the brotherhood. Love the brotherhood. What is the brotherhood? In this context, it means you are brothers and sisters locked in arms, digging deep the mine of the church. Finding those precious pearls and jewels of prayer, of asceticism, of noetic experience. That's loving the brotherhood. It's honoring each other. It's honoring the saints. It's honoring our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave us the church. Fear God. Without the fear of God, salvation is impossible. Always remember that God has given us commandments, and in that respect of the commandments God has given us, we have that motivation. You know, it says, do not be like the horse or the mule who without bitter bridle will not come, right? But you know, a lot of us are horses and mules still. I know I am. Remember the fear of God. It's the beginning of wisdom. Lastly, honoring the king. This is so key in times of civil unrest, potential civil unrest, and tensions. There's plenty of people who have a political agenda, right or wrong. There's plenty of people who have different ideas of how they want to make things go the way they want them to go, right or wrong. Brothers and sisters, I'm going to be very frank with you. That's not your job. It's not your job. Your job as Orthodox Christians is to learn how to pray, to learn how to fast so that you can pray, to love God, to honor the church. When you do those things, you embody Christ, which is, that's what's lacking. That's the one thing that's not happening. No one is out there saying, the cross, the cross, the cross. Dr. James Cone, the father of Black liberation theology, he was asked at a conference once, they asked him, you know, I'm paraphrasing, Dr. Cone, like, what is the thing the Black church needs to know? And, you know, Dr. Cone says, the Black church needs to learn how to die. And everyone's like, oh, what? What are you talking about? Dr. Cone's answer was very orthodox, actually. Because the one thing no one wants to do, including many Orthodox Christians, is die. They want to protect their property. They want to protect their status. They want to protect all the things that they hold dear. But guess what? All of it is rubbish. Because every single one of us are going to go in the ground. I'm sorry to be so honest. But this is orthodoxy. Orthodoxy is the sweeping away of all the kind of flowery stuff that we've been fed as American Christians. And it gets to the root. It shows you the master who died on Golgotha. But it also shows you the one who rose again from the dead. But there's no crown without a cross. So when you honor the king, this is what this means. It's never about being compliant when you see wicked things happen. Never be compliant. The Lord was not compliant with those things. But there's a way that he shows us. And when we honor the king, and I like to look at it like during the litanies, when it talks about having a peaceful life, right? It's not about going along with everything like it's okay. What it's about is trusting God. Please do me a favor and don't say to someone, well, all we can do is pray. Don't ever say that. Don't ever say that to someone. The best thing you can do is actually pray. Because if you actually learn what prayer means, then that's how you can acquire the grace to be like the martyrs who went to their death willingly. That death isn't always going to be a physical death. Sometimes it's going to be the death of your personal dignity. Sometimes it's going to be the death of you wanting to say that last word. Oh, I'm going to get this last post in. You know what I mean? This guy said this. I'm going to log off. No, don't do that. Don't do that. Instead, turn to prayer. And I mean that in a very practical sense. Don't just wear your prayer robes. Use them. Don't just have icons as decorations in your home. Enter into the kingdom through them. If we can do that, then we can learn to be good citizens. And when we're good citizens, right, people will sit and they'll awe and they'll give thanks to the works of our Father in heaven. But we have to unpack what that means. And that's not for me to do. That's for you to do. Because for you to honor all men, for you to love the brotherhood, for you to fear God, for you to honor the king, there's a bigger thing that we're all in agreement with, and that's the larger culture of the church. That's where we learn that, yes. But there's also a very unique aspect to it that you're gonna have to find that out, because it's different in Atlanta than it is in Kansas City, than it is in California. And I wanna encourage you to do that. I wanna encourage you to open up your minds and have the courage to have that dialogue with each other and with your neighbors. I know I've gone over my time. I guess I'll say the last thing. Father Tom and Mother gave me incredible hospitality. And it was interesting. Something flew out of my mouth, and I didn't understand why it flew out of my mouth. But I started talking to them about, like, oh, you know, we're so small. Like, the number of Orthodox Christians are so small. Too many cooks in a kitchen can be bad. Too many cooks in a kitchen can be bad. And something that I've come to realize is, as I talk with people, we all have these similar experiences of coming to Orthodoxy. It's like, man, I'm at home. It's mystical. I don't understand it. All I know is that the Lord has brought us here. So do your job and get cooking. All right? Prepare the food that needs to be passed out there, because no one else is doing it. The shepherds, the leaders, they're not doing it. You've been given this rich, bountiful feast of patristic understanding. Start cooking it up and start serving it out there. Thank you.
Thank you, Father Deacon. That's a tremendous talk. We are scheduled right now to have a Q&A with Father Deacon Turbo, but because the schedule has been kind of pushed, we're going to go ahead and go to break right now, a brief break, and then we'll come back and hear from Father Jerome. And then after that, we'll have a panel discussion, at which time we'll also include a Q&A where everybody can have questions, hopefully prepared, to ask the group. Father Jerome, if you'll join me in welcoming him.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Glory to Jesus Christ.
Glory.
The idea of racial reconciliation has been circling around more and more the last few years. And the more I thought about it, the more I felt like it's just a small part of what reconciliation really is. Because all the scripture is basically pointing us to reconciliation. One, both with our brother and with God. And today we have many issues. We have terrorists to think about. We need reconciliation there. We have a high level of divorce. There's a marital reconciliation that's needed. We have a high level of children leaving the church and family conflict. And so there's reconciliation there. We need political reconciliation. One of those despairing times on Facebook, I watched the Republicans saying, oh, the Democrats are so dumb. And then you go a little bit further and the Democrats are saying, oh, the Republicans are so dumb. How can they be so ignorant? And I think, boy, we're really in trouble. And it doesn't work to sometimes to talk about it from certain angles. In other words, I know a lot of my black friends would want to have, you know, talk to white people and say, this is what you're doing to us. And it's your fault. And a lot of white people are thinking, well, it's your fault. You're not really getting jobs and so forth. And casting blame is not the way either. And so reconciliation doesn't come by blaming. In fact, that act of blaming is a very clear indication that you're in the wrong place. Do you know where when the first blame was ever cast? It's when God asked Adam, Adam, why did you eat that apple? And he says, Eve made me eat it. And then he says, Eve, why did you eat it? She says, the serpent beguiled me. Well, that was an indication that they had fallen from grace. Adam could no longer, you know, he was given the job of naming the beast, right, and all that. He couldn't even name his own beast, which was pride, gluttony. He didn't know himself. The answer to reconciliation is written in the scripture. And if you read this Bible, just looking at the need for reconciliation, you see it's all over the place. You see it with Jacob and Esau. You know, Jacob stole Esau's birthright, remember that? And then took off to visit his wife's brother, Laban. And there he got two wives and 10 sons and a daughter, 12 sons and a daughter. And then came back and was afraid that his brother was going to kill him. But his brother had repented and they embraced and they were reconciled. You know about Joseph, the son of Jacob, who was sold into slavery by his brothers. We have the prodigal son who took his inheritance and went off and lived a shameful life. And then he came to himself. What does it mean to come to yourself? It means to see your sin, to realize what you've done. And he said, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. And he says, I'll go back to my father and tell him that. And his father, when he saw him coming, ran and he said his words, I've sinned before heaven and thee, and I'm not worried to be thy son. Make me as thy hired servant. And his father gave him the ring, the robe and the shoes, and killed the fatted calf. Now that's reconciliation. Now in all these stories, and there's the prodigal, the Pharisee and the publican. Interesting, you had the holy man there, the so-called Pharisee, that thanked God that he wasn't like other men, and condemned, he said, I'm glad I'm not like this man, this tax collector. And if he'd only known the grace that that tax collector was receiving in that moment because of his tears and his sorrow, he had come to himself too, like the prodigal son. And so, what is needed for all Christians is that coming to oneself. And that's a hard thing because we're proud people. You know, it's interesting that Zacchaeus, because he was a short stature, climbed up in a tree, but Jesus had come down because he was up there. But really, he's talking to all of us. We should come down from our high place because it's through humility that we begin to see ourselves. And the problem of racism, the problem of marital disharmony, the problem of conflict with just about every situation always has pride at its core. And it's always instigated by the enemy, the proud one, Satan, Lucifer. And so we wrestle not against flesh and blood, and that's important to remember. We have to remember that when we're hearing who's being shot up in this nightclub or that nightclub, when we hear of terrorism coming in. This is the work of Satan. His work is to divide, to conquer, to make us hate each other. And we have to see that. So that we just, you know, it's like two boys and there are two dogs sleeping with each other and one threw a rock on one dog and the dog snaps at the other one, the other one throws a rock on that other one. Pretty soon the dogs are fighting and the boys are laughing. That's what the demons try to do with us, to divide us. But the scripture is very clear on what's needed. Now, the most important reconciliation is our reconciliation with God. In Romans 5, it says, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. In another verse, it says, and all things are of God who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. Now that ministry of reconciliation is all of our work. In the Beatitudes, Christ says, blessed are the peacemakers. And that bringing harmony is an important work. Now it's an interesting thing about our situation. Hearing about the racial harmony, the fear of Islam and terrorism, the the fear of policemen by some, the fear of all these things, I thought, what did Jesus do? And I looked at his situation. Do you know that he was in a very racially tense country? The Romans were there, and the Jews wanted somebody that would lead them in war to eliminate the Romans. They hated the Romans. Talk about racial conflict. And I looked through the scripture, because Jesus never commented on them. This is the one they thought would lead them. No, he said, love your enemies. Do good to them that hate you, that despitefully use you. Turn the other cheek. And you know, his words have pretty much been ignored. And this is the scary thing, is that we Christians have heard the scripture so much that sometimes it has no power in our lives. I mean, who really tries to love God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength? You know, there was an app that was invented. And I have to clarify that this is a joke, because people have said, I'd like to get that app after I told the story. So I want to make clear that this is a joke. But it told you what your priorities were. You strapped it on, and it followed, you know, and you just did what you did for a week, and then you take a look at it, and it would tell you what were the most important things in your life. And Christians hated it, because there was eating, sleeping, watching TV were up there in the top three. And way down about number 16 was, when some of the places it was 45, was church, or prayer for others. And they said, no, I love God. But it doesn't show by your activity. We are so busy and consumed with the world that we don't even begin to approach the first commandment, loving God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. That's kind of scary, because Jesus says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I'm thinking, then who loves him? Because we're so busy surfing the internet, doing everything but loving God, and praying deeply, and loving our neighbor. And so today, I don't want to talk about racial conciliation by itself, because the very tools and principles that are needed for that to happen are the same tools that are needed and essential for marital harmony, for political harmony, for harmony in your employment situation. Now, there are certain things that contribute to reconciliation. Forgiveness is essential. Without forgiveness, there's no reconciliation. You know, forgiveness is just about the only virtue that Jesus put in the Lord's Prayer. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. He doesn't say, and as we are humble, or as we are loving, or as we, you know, he says forgiveness, because forgiveness is so key. There was a story, a true story, it's in the book The Arena, about two monks, Titus and Evagrius, who loved each other with such a love that it was inspiring to all the other brothers. They wanted to have that kind of pure brotherly love that they had. But Satan sowed enmity between them. And soon they got to the point where they wouldn't be in the same room with the other. They would not talk to each other. They were so bitter and so resentful that it was a hard thing. The brothers tried to get them to forgive, and they wouldn't. And Titus got sick, and he got sicker and sicker, and asked them to bring Evagrius to him. And he didn't want to come, evangelist, so they dragged him in. And Titus got out of the bed and knelt down and says, it was all my fault. I beg you, forgive me, because it was me, I was wrong. You were right, and I just didn't see it. Please forgive me. And then Evagrius said these awful words. He raised his arm and he said, I will not forgive him in this life or the next. And he turned to leave and fell dead. And then Titus, who was so sickly and kind of laying on the floor from being so sick, he jumped up whole and strong, and the brothers were shocked. And they said, what happened? He says, well, early this morning, I saw my angels leaving and weeping over my state. And I saw the demons celebrating their victory over my soul, congratulating themselves that I was theirs. And so I asked you to bring Evagrius in that I might apologize. And when he said those awful words, I saw an angel stab him in the heart with a spear. Now, I tell you this story because it shows the importance of forgiveness. Forgiveness is so key in reconciliation. A number of times in my life, hearing confessions, I've had people come and say, Father, my brother and I haven't spoken in 8 years. It really breaks my heart that he won't talk to me. He won't come, the door's shut, he won't answer his phone. And so I give them a penance. I say, every day, every night, you're to pray for him for 10 minutes or more. And you are to not just say, Lord, straighten him out, you know, make him come or whatever. You just pray that God would bless him, open his heart to life. Be his intercessor, his angel. The first time I did that, the girl called me on that Wednesday. I had given her the penance on the Sunday. 3 days later, she said, my brother called me tonight. He wants to get together. Now, that's happened a number of times because prayer is powerful if we will use it. And often people say, what can I do beside pray? I said, no, prayer is a good place to begin and sometimes to end. God will lead it. Forgiveness and prayer. We must be praying for the world. We see the situation. We need, as Christians, to be praying for these situations. But we're so busy with TV and all the different things that we have that we can't do the work that Jesus has called us to. You know, it's scary to me that, you know, Jesus in Matthew 25 talks about because you gave me water to drink when I was thirsty and food when I was hungry and clothing when I was naked and visited me in prison, etc. Enter ye into, you know, he put them on the right hand, the sheep. Then he said to the goats, because you didn't do those things. Well, that's a scary thing. And yet, how many people live that way, where they're giving and visiting and dedicating their lives in some way to at least helping a little? The reason why not is because we don't take the scripture seriously. We don't make it our guide in life. I mean, God, he is to be our eternal beloved. And he gives us a commandment. And we're worse than our kids in terms of obedience. I know my sons would disobey me. I say, what? And they say, oh, I'm going to go do it real quick. But we, when our Father commands something, we think, well, who can do that? Well, I'm too busy. And we really tend to disregard the scripture. If we knew the power it had to change our lives, to heal us, to bring peace and joy, I mean, that's what Jesus wanted. How often he prayed that we would have his joy. that we enter into the fullness of his joy. But his commandments are our guide, and they are the key to reconciliation. Judgment. Jesus commands us not to judge, and this is kind of confusing because there are issues out there, for instance, abortion. We can say, because the church teaches that abortion is wrong, but we can't say that that person that's had abortion is evil or bad or even worse than us. That's the difference. We're not judging our brother. I can't say that that terrorist who beheaded that Coptic person or whatever is evil. I believe that Satan is evil and has perhaps influenced him. But as far as I know, he may be taking his scripture more seriously than we're taking ours. And the Quran does tell him to behead this unbelievers. And so judgment is something that we have to learn is an abrogation of authority. God is the judge. That Pharisee in the temple saying, I'm glad I'm not like that man, made himself a judge. You know, in Philippians it says, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind let each esteem others better than themselves. And that's one of those scriptures where people go, what? That person isn't better than me. That's a hard saying, to think of other people. Everyone else is better than you. But we say it every liturgy, don't we? We say, I believe in Christ. You know, then we say, who came to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Is everyone lying at that moment, or just saying, or maybe some people just skip that part? Because they don't really believe that. But that's what the saints believed. They thought they were first, and they wept tears over sins that we would feel proud of, because they're so insignificant to us. But the greater light casts a greater shadow. Ignorance. Ignorance is a terrible thing in many ways. Of course, we're all ignorant on some level. But it's important to know that we're ignorant. It's important that we know that we don't know the hearts of these people. We don't know what they've been through or the influence on their lives. We don't know. It doesn't justify shooting up somebody or whatever, but we don't know. And that poor soul may need our prayer, not our condemnation. And so we must realize that we don't know. That's an important thing. That's one of the highest knowledges, is that we're ignorant and we're blind. You know, the Pharisees, when Jesus was talking about blind guys and all that, said, are you saying that we are blind? And he says, if you were blind, you would have no sin, but because you think you see, your sin remains. That's a lot of the person that's proud and thinks they know, is that they're held to and are accountable for something that they really aren't, can't live up to. Lack of self-knowledge. I talked about the prodigal son who came to himself. And that's all it says, but there is an awakening that happens in Christian souls. Ideally, by the power of the Holy Spirit, they come to see their sins. And the truth is that when a person truly sees his sins, he weeps. This is something that the monks of Orthodox monks cherish, is tears, because they know that this person has come to a certain depth of spirituality where he sees himself and sees the offense. Many years ago, about 30 years ago, I was taken to account by my brother priest. Father Jacob was one of them. And they called me in and told me how self-centered I was, and I was going, I see a lot of self-centeredness. I didn't say it out loud. But I wanted to say, oh yeah, well you are, you know, I didn't do that at that time, but they put me on retreat for 3 weeks to look at myself, to read books on contrition and compunction. And the first week I was probably spent, you know, resentful of them and think, oh, those guys, why did they, you know, and so forth. But by the end of that time, it was Father Jacob that actually came up to the cabin where I was and knelt and prayed for me while I was reading something and really struggling to get the point. And suddenly my eyes were opened and I saw what a proud, vain, self-centered, self-serving person I was. I had never seen that. And I'd been a priest already for 14 or 15 years. And I was shocked. I wept, I cried. Now, I'm sorry to say that's the last time I wept and cried. But I saw what I was, I woke up. That was the grace of God. They say that contrition comes by the Holy Spirit. And it was the prayers of my brothers and all that opened my eyes. And even though I have not been honored with such an experience again, that never left me, the knowledge that I don't know and that I'm blind. And that's a good knowledge to have. That's a grace. And it will help you through many times when somebody accuses you of something. There's that voice that will say, they might be right. You know, you don't see it sometimes, but you might say, I know I've been blind with other things. They might be right. And you hear it. And so self-knowledge is very important. This is why we go to confession. This is why we read these confessions by these holy people. And we seek to see in ourselves those things. And this is why we try to prepare for communion by going before the great physician and getting every speck of sin out of ourselves by confessing it. I've had people come to confession and say, well, I was pretty good this week. And I prayed a lot and I did this and that. And it's like going to the doctor and the doctor saying, what can I do for you? You know, you've got cancer right here, and you're saying, well, my knees, they're bending pretty good these days, and my teeth, they're strong, no cavities, and so forth. We need to go there eager to have everything brought to light and cleansed, so that when the body of Christ enters into our bodily temple, it finds a seat, so to speak. It finds a place, and thereout can radiate the holiness, the sanctity, the blessing of Jesus Christ. Now, there are things that are barriers to reconciliation. Pride. This is what made Satan fall from heaven. This is what made Adam and Eve fall from paradise. It has been the cause of many falls. In fact, as the old saying goes, pride goeth before a fall. And there's probably not one of us in this room that doesn't have at least a smidgen of pride. Because that's human nature, and our enemy is working continuously to make us proud. And unfortunately, the movies we watch, the things we see, they all urge us to be proud. I mean, you see who the kids want to be. They want to be Iron Man or, you know, all these different hero roles, and they dream of karate chopping the bully. And, you know, like the big guy comes at them, and I've had these fantasies as a kid, you know, and they start to beat on them, and they just go, ha, ha, and then the bully's down, and all the kids say, whoa, I didn't know you could fight that way. That's our dream. Of course, some of you guys probably never had those kind, but I did. And so this is put in us by the world, by the enemy. And it's contrary to what Christ God came to bring us. He said, blessed are the meek. The proud shall be abased, and the humble shall be exalted. He said, come down, Lazarus. And I take that to mean, come down, Jerome, from your high seat. And racism is putting yourself above somebody else, thinking that they're worse than you. And that's rampant in our world today. And we, if we live the commandments, we will be each a seed of righteousness. Not that we should think that of ourselves, but those that live the commandments, they pray for their enemies, they do good for those that despitefully use them, they turn the other cheek, they have power. There's a story, you probably heard this story about a monk. Well, there was a father whose daughter was possessed back in early centuries. And he was told that if he goes to the marketplace, there was a monk there that was very holy and could come and heal his daughter. But says, don't tell him that you want him to come and heal the daughter because he's so humble, he won't come. But if you tell him that you want to buy his baskets, he'll come. And so the man went to the marketplace, found the monk, and says, I would like to buy some baskets. Could you come to my house? And the man and the monk came, but even before they got into the house, the daughter saw him coming and rushed out and slapped him on the cheek. And very humbly, he turned the other one to her. And the demon screamed and came out of her because he couldn't stand that humility. And the daughter was healed. But for most of us, when we hear turn the other cheek, we go, no way, he hit me, he's going to get hit back. I was at boys' camp this week, and I asked him that question. I said, and we read that gospel, and I said, would you turn the other cheek? Not a one said that they would. Of course, they're young, and they have an excuse. But we don't take the scripture seriously. We don't take our Lord's words seriously. And that is very critical. That is very important. The Brotherhood of St. Moses the Black is not a black organization. We are very much mixed. In fact, we have a very unusual phenomenon. My wife is white. Father Moses' wife is white. Father Alexei, who was married, he's white. His wife was black. Turbo's wife is white. And I've looked at that, I don't know why. But in a certain way, it's just kind of living reconciliation in a way. Al Rabiteau, his wife was white. And he's divorced since, but. And so we are very mixed brotherhood. And our work isn't just reaching out to black people, even that's a thing. We want to spread the gospel and the message, the teaching about the African saints, the slave martyrs, the fathers of the desert. But our work is very much probing the scripture, trying to make it real and alive. And reading the African fathers, the desert fathers, and getting insight, because they spent their lives in prayer. They spent day after day, moment after moment, seeking to pray unceasingly and achieved it. And they wrote down their success. And it's quite an amazing thing that we have these records that show us how to enter more fully into the life in Christ by people who were masters at it. And so the Brotherhood isn't just about racial reconciliation. It's about reconciliation with God. It's about reconciliation with each other. It's about reconciliation with our wives, our children, our bosses. Because reconciliation is important. And the ultimate reconciliation being reconciliation of God can't happen if we're not reconciled with our body, brother. As Jesus says, if you bring your gift to the altar and remember that your brother has aught against you, leave your gift and go be reconciled with your brother. Now, if everybody did that, there might not be anyone at communion sometimes on Sundays. I mean, this means everybody, you know, not that we can, but there are people that have hurt you, that have done wrong things to you. And it isn't to say that they were right, but we have to forgive, because we ask God to forgive us as we forgive them. And if we continue to resent them, then we are, in a certain way, telling God, I only want to be forgiven 4%. Because that's all I'm willing to forgive. And so we've got to search out resentment. We've got to pray for our enemies. We've got to take seriously the commandments. And only then will we be a force in this world for reconciliation. We're not going to be able to talk it out. And we're not going to be saying, you know, you all have white privilege, and we, you know, you can't do that. It doesn't work. It causes resentment. But when we live the commandments, then we begin to embody the love that God has. And amazing things happen.
The next part of this discussion is going to be a panel discussion. And it's going to be obviously between Father Jerome, Father Deacon Turbo, and then Basil Moses, and then Father Tom is here as well. But first, I just want to say thank you to all three of you from the bottom of my heart, from the bottom of our hearts, for having come here. It's been just such a blessing, and it's been so enriching everything that you guys have said. I found myself wondering how kind of you were going to tie the racial reconciliation within the context of Orthodox Christianity. And as kind of we've been preparing for this meeting, I was like, oh, I wonder how that's going to be approached and what's going to be said. Anyways, it was just delightful. Gave us, I think, all so much to think about, and hearing your own personal stories. So thank you.
Thank you.
And there's another person that I want to say thank you to. The Brotherhood of St. Moses the Black Atlanta chapter. It's his vision. Not only that, everything that we're enjoying from the speakers and the lineup and to the food, it's his administration and the help of his lovely wife. And that was Cecil Mitchell and Tony Mitchell. Thank you.
Many years.
We really appreciate you. So as I was preparing these questions, and then as I kind of submitted them to the larger group and we kind of looked them over and talked back and forth, I had in my mind that, you know, it was highly possible that throughout all of your speeches that a lot of this would probably already be addressed, and lo and behold, some of it has. But maybe this will be give us an opportunity to actually have it articulated in a more poignant manner and more directly. That said, I know that we already have some introductions, but I just wanted to just highlight a few things. There were some things that we kind of asked and had y'all answer before the panel here today. But Father Deacon Turbo, you're from Southern California, but right?
Originally.
Now I'm
in Kansas City.
Now you're in Kansas City. You've been an Orthodox Christian, you and your family, for 10 years, right? And you have been a part of the Brotherhood of St. Moses since 2008, began your own chapter in 2011, and now you currently reside on the board since 2013. Is that
correct?
Right?
Correct.
Subdeacon Basil Moses, I mean, me and you, we've been at this parish for a very long time, and I haven't been here 20 years, I've been here, I think, 7, but yeah, you've been here, a very long time, and originally from North Carolina, right?
North Carolina.
Orthodox Christian of 20 years, and your involvement with the Brotherhood of St. Moses in some capacities has been since the beginning.
I want to clarify, I knew about it, and just recently, of course, getting on board, so I want to make sure that I am truthful. I knew and got the book from Father Moses, and over the years have had a connection, and knew about the conferences, but for Atlanta chapter, I'm plugging into Atlanta.
Got it.
Amen.
And Father Jerome, you have been a priest for many, many years. How long have you been involved with the Brotherhood of St. Moses?
23, 24 years. This is actually our 23rd conference coming up in October.
Glory to God.
Well, this, in October, it will be our 23rd consecutive conference.
Pardon?
But you've been a priest for how long, Father?
Well, I've been ordained 3 different times. I was ordained a canonical Orthodox person in 2000, but I was first ordained in 1972 as a priest in the Brotherhood, the order. And then in 1991, I think I was ordained a priest under Pangradios, who wasn't really a canonical bishop. So I couldn't enter the Bulgarian Church under the Patriarch, and I was ordained in 2000.
All right, thanks so much. I have 7 questions here. That might be a little bit ambitious, but we'll see exactly how it goes. So I know that we have 3 people, and not everybody has to answer every single one, but if you have, you know, if you want to chime in, everybody is absolutely welcome.
Let her rip.
Let her rip. Okay, so the first question that we have is that the title of our gathering is One Heart, One Mind, a Gathering of Racial Reconciliation in Orthodox Christianity. As Orthodox Christians in a multicultural, multi-ethnic society, can you give us your thoughts on our aim here, that being oneness of heart and mind? What are we looking to achieve?
Father?
You know, it brings to mind the story of Babylon, where because they had one language, but no love of God, they God saw that they could do anything because of their unity. And so he scattered them. He changed their languages so that they weren't the one language, one mind, and all that. Because that was not a good thing. But you have in Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came down upon disciples, it says in the scripture that they were in one place and one mind. Then the Holy Spirit came upon them, and the people from all the countries around heard them speak, even though they were speaking in Aramaic or whatever their language was, they were hearing them in their own language. And there was a unity. And real unity comes only by the Holy Spirit. It is not something that you can force. You can form a club and, you know, try to be there. You know, Satan will divide it. And the only protection against division is the grace of the Spirit that keeps us united. And communion is very much involved in that outpouring of the Spirit. And it's through the common cup that we are further united each week. And it takes doing it each week, though, because we kind of lose the grace because of our willingness to plunge back into the world and into our concerns and troubles. But unity will always be in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. To the degree we are there, to that degree we will be unified.
Basically. Yep.
I guess one thing I would also want to say is that...
Do you want to pass this down?
Also, the verse in Acts where it says, Acts chapter 4:32, we're talking about all the believers were in one heart and mind, and one thing that they had in possession of their own, that they shared everything they had, the gifts. I know that I have God, they're not my own, I have to share them so others may be edified. So that's really what I want to comment and add about.
Okay, great, thank you. All right, so moving on to our second question. The subtitle of this gathering is A Gathering on Racial Reconciliation, which naturally implies the need for healing from disharmony or disunity. Can you give us your thoughts on the nature of racial disunity, both its root and essence, as well as practical examples on how it manifests itself?
I'm a firm believer that the root and essence behind racial disunity is found in the fragmentation that happens at the fall. And you see man turning against everything by turning towards himself initially. Racism is interesting because the phenomena leads someone to make an idol out of their ethnicity or their the color of their skin in many regards. And this idol ends up distorting, making a caricature of their own culture so that they're not able to really see their culture honestly. And when that distortion happens, then the next kick in from that, you know, it's like this passion building on another passion, is the disdain for others. And it's an interesting thing because this is the same thing, to kind of lead off of what Father Jerome was saying, you see this with marriages. Ultimately, I mean, there's always exceptions, things happen, you know, but I would say in a general sense, that thing with marriages where they dissolve is because one of the spouses decided to turn inward and refuse to serve the other. And it's in the turning inward, not in a way to seek God or to seek repentance, because we say that a lot in our tradition, turning inward. I don't mean turning inward to seek God, but turning inward and turning away from the other and turning towards yourself. It says in Proverbs that a selfish man isolates himself. And so that type of isolation is what you see when you have these kind of like hyper-ethnic movements. And so, interestingly enough, I think this is one of the most profound things about God, the God-man, right? In Christ being fully God and fully man, he takes these seemingly opposites and brings them together. And it's through that uniting of his two natures that we're able to literally see how it's possible for man to be reconciled with woman, for man to be reconciled with other men, for man to be reconciled with creation. And I think that's the big thing, is understanding fragmentation. It's a separation that happens, you know. I think that's like what's at the root of it.
One thing I've appreciated about the conversation so far is that, you know, the theme is reconciliation among races, but I think there's been a great kind of even lifting of that, and just talking about the reconciliation of, you know, how that applies, you know, outside of that, and how it has really this kind of this cosmic dynamic to it. And I just, you know, I think that that's something that I have kind of noticed throughout all of your speeches, and I think it's a really nice thing to think about. Okay. Can you provide us an example from your own life experience of a time or a situation where you experienced unity between peoples of varying cultural and ethnic backgrounds, as well as an experience of disunity or discord among peoples of varying cultural and ethnic backgrounds?
Yeah. Interestingly enough, you know, I personally have found, before coming to the church, I found that experience for me in subculture. And in subculture, one of the things that I found was, if I was at a punk rock show, let's say, you find all stripes of people, usually. And the thing about that is, when you're able to speak to something common, right? Let me back up a little bit. So in that context of, like, let's say a punk rock show, you have this very simplistic, often simplistic music, boiled down, and it can almost seem tribal in some respects. But the profundity is, in the simplicity, people are able to enter in with whatever context they got. So in other words, you know, you got an African-American kid from the suburbs, you got an Irish American kid from the inner city. You got, you know, you got a young lady whose parents, you know, are from Bengal. You have all these different types of people that they're able to enter into something simple, and that's without Christ. That's without Christ. I think that there are these expressions that we have to be careful not to demonize in regards to like human expressions of art. And this is important for the church to understand, because St. Herman of Alaska, when he went to the Aleuts and the Inuits and the people of America, he looked very differently at those cultures as opposed to, not to be in such a generalized sense, but as opposed to what they did in the West, where there was, okay, you savages, we're going to turn you into Spanish people. That's not what the Orthodox did. The Orthodox came in generally, you know, again, St. Herman, and looked at what those indigenous cultures were doing. And, you know, it says in the scripture, when you're able to extrapolate the precious from the worthless, then you will become my servants. So being able to look at what people are already doing that might be good, that might be a source of unity for them, don't destroy that. And then when you recognize that, and you pray through it, and, you know, we baptize things in the Orthodox Church, you know. So to answer more succinctly, I find a lot of correlation between that and my coming into Orthodoxy, because in Orthodoxy, if you are blessed to be in a community where the emphasis is on Christ, the emphasis is on experiencing Christ, then you get these beautiful expressions. Like in our parish, we sing Wade in the Water during baptism. Every baptism we sing that, right? It's something that's organic, it's natural. People love it, right? There's a freedom that comes with the simplicity of the church. And there's a freedom that comes when people simply enter into this idea of honoring all men, like St. Herman did with those indigenous people in Alaska. So I've had that experience in and out of the church, but I think the guiding principle is the same, and that is, you know, God takes us and honors us where we're at, and he always continually asks us to go deeper and higher, if you will. You know?
So, with that in mind, what is needed for a culture of varying backgrounds to facilitate and grow in oneness of heart and mind?
Freedom. Freedom, you know. You have to give, you have to give people space. I have six kids, like I said. I'm a long ways from raising them. My oldest is 15, but I will tell you, already I've kind of hit that, hit some of the rough spots with him. And I was reading, and Elder Porfirio said, his advice to a mother who was struggling, he said, talk more to God about your child than to your child about God, right?
Yes.
For me, that's a lot about freedom, meaning I'm going to trust God in his life, and I'm also going to trust him and his experience of God. You know, you always have to give guidance. You know, people, how will they know unless someone is sent to them? That's what the scripture says. But I think the thing that I've seen is when my group of inquirers came in, there was kind of two splinter groups. There was the main group who came in with my wife and I, and there were some people that were on the periphery who we knew, but they ended up at another parish. And the parish we were at, they gave us freedom. We were just a bunch of, like, you know, punk rock kids with tattoos, and the priests there just, they loved us, and they gave us freedom to mature into Orthodoxy. The other group, not so much. The community there was very focused on the externals of those kids, and they are not in the church anymore. And I would dare say this is one of the things, when you look at poll after poll after poll, which I've done, of why millennials aren't Christians anymore, why they're leaving churches. There's something that comes up consistently, and it also comes up consistently why African American men are not in church. And that is, there's this perceived bigotry and kind of like narrowness of who's accepted. And I think that is something that needs to be done away with, because especially in Orthodoxy, that's why there's so many saints, because there's so many different types of people, there's so many different types of contexts and situation. And if we just give people the freedom to experience God, let them come to the services, let them pray, and don't rush them, then people will find themselves where they need to be at in the church. It's very important to give people that freedom, my opinion.
I appreciate that answer, because freedom and Orthodoxy's emphasis on the freedom of the human person was really one of the things that brought me to the Orthodox Church to begin with. You know, there are many things that brought me to Orthodoxy. That was certainly one of them, is the emphasis on freedom. And I felt that that was such a deep spiritual reality that was so not only recognized but respected within the Orthodox Church, not always by every person within the Orthodox Church, but you know, I think that that certainly is, you know, certainly a teaching of the saints all the way through the 2,000-year patristic tradition that just was just so powerful to me. So, and another thing I think about is that kind of, you know, what is needed for a community of varying backgrounds to facilitate and grow in oneness of heart and mind. And Father Jerome, you kind of mentioned this in your talk, was just the fruit of Pentecost, you know, and that unity must flow from that, you know, one spirit, which is, you know, the Trinity. And without it, we're just, it's going to be just continual division, and that really is our center as Christians. This next question, I think it's a really, rather difficult one to answer. Maybe you'll answer it very easily, I don't know, we'll see. But for myself, I'm a lover of cultures. You know, I love African-American culture, I love Anglo-American culture, I love Italian and French and Russian and Slavic cultures, right? So, so that in mind, how do we persevere and facilitate unity among varying cultures without eroding the unique identity and characteristics that makes each so wonderful?
I'd just like to quote St. Augustine. St. Augustine had a very simple formula. He said, diversity in essentials, unity in essentials, and love overall.
Amen. I mean, so in our parish, it's interesting, at St. Mary of Egypt, like a lot of Orthodox parishes, there has been, to a greater or lesser degree, a large Eritrean and Ethiopian percentage. You know, originally very much formed in the kind of tradition of St. John and Father Sarah from Rose, on that lineage coming down through Abbot Gerasim, you know, who was the godfather of Father Paisis, now Father Alexi. So when you walk in the parish, it's very American. You have Ethiopian icons, you have, you know, Russian tones, and we're a Serbian parish with African Americans, Eritreans, Ethiopians, and the various stripes of, like, you know, European Americans, you know. I think the thing is, again, is being able to have the freedom to do that. Because one of the, for all the problems we have being American Orthodox, and there's definite problems, one of the things that we have the ability to do is, we have the ability to kind of sit at the table of Orthodoxy to some degree, and if we can do it without being disrespectful to the traditions, enjoy them. And that's something that I personally enjoy. I enjoy the fact that, you know, I have, you know, an Ethiopian icon, like, in the nave I can look at. I enjoy the fact, you know, all the various facets. I mean, that's a beautiful thing. And I think it's a uniquely American thing. It's one of the things we can point to and go like, you know, it's kind of who we are as Americans to some degree. You know, we gotta kind of embrace it a little bit.
You know, along this question, you know, I just, correct me if I'm articulating this, you know, wrongly, but I can't help but think about just the Trinity and how it is one and three, and how the oneness isn't contrasted or contradicted by, you know, each hypostasis, you know, each member of the Holy Trinity. There's no contradiction between the one and the three. And so, you know, while we are one, you know, there are some, you know, unique cultural identities that I find so beautiful, right, and that I ultimately want to respect. Without, you know, in my own heart, creating tension.
You know, I just, there's this thing that I think we don't understand, especially because we're not a Semitic culture, and that is the idea of hospitality. right? But there's two parts to hospitality. You know, you have to be a good guest and you have to be a good host, right? So what happens is, I think a lot of parishes that are, you know, quote unquote, you know, what we might say, and we say it often in a despairing way, we shouldn't, let's say an ethnic parish, right? So you have this parish that's predominantly Greek. If I show up there, I need to be a good guest. If I'm being shown Christian love and hospitality at this predominantly Greek parish, I'm not gonna come in there and bust it up and say, ah, what is this? Like, why is there Greek in the liturgy here? And why are you serving domas during like coffee hour? Why are you doing, like, you don't do that. You're being a bad guest, right? Now, if I show up and I'm, you know, haristo, you know what I mean? I know a little bit of Greek. I'm trying to show that I'm respectful. And they just don't want me there because of I'm not Greek, then that's on them, right? They need to be good Christian hosts. Because remember, that's one of the reasons why Abraham got favor, right? Because he hosted the Lord when he showed up, right, and the angels. So a good guest and a good host. And I think if we have that principle, that will help us kind of navigate orthodoxy. Because when you go somewhere and you're traveling and you end up at whatever, you know, a Carpatho-Russian parish, just be a good guest, you know? And if someone doesn't host you like you'd like, you know, God have mercy, and you just kind of move on. We need to really mature to some degree. There's this phenomena that we expect everyone to kind of bend to us, and that's not mature, and that's not also Christian either. Honor all men, right? Honor all men.
I hope this doesn't sound too superficial in a way, but what helps in being with different peoples is the recognition that we are with Christ. And as Christ says, as you do to the least, you do to me. And it's not just serving somebody, but it's learning to see Christ in everyone. And that sometimes frees them, even though it's not a physical thing that you do, you don't talk differently when you see Christ in them. But that recognition and that practice of trying to see Christ in each person, it opens doors that we unconsciously shut. You know, being uncomfortable with this people or that. Sometimes we put out body language and things that kind of indicate that we're not comfortable or we don't like somebody. And that becomes a barrier. You know, we don't realize the barriers we put out. And that recognition of Christ, that prayerfulness, that state of always wanting to be the temple of the Holy Spirit and living that, changes how we react to people. With the saints, it went so far as that even with wild animals, as you know, they reacted differently to them because of where they were in their interior self. They recognize the God in the saint that we don't recognize. And so there is a reality to it that it's easy to almost sound cliche, you know, see the God in everybody, you know. But there is a reality of what happens as you follow the commandments and you begin to see who your brother is, and that deepens with your relationship with Christ. You've seen that illustration, they had like a bicycle wheel and the spokes going to the center. The hub is supposed to be symbolic of God, and the outer is the outer world. And it says the closer you get to God, the closer you get to your brother, because the spokes all represent your brother. Out in the world, they're far apart. The closer you get to God, the closer you get to each other. And so that's a principle that really works in multicultures, but it's a subtle thing. It's not something that you do with yourself. It's something that you do in relationship to Christ. And it makes a big difference. And that's something that you just have to strive for. It's not something that, well, I'm going to do that tomorrow.
Right.
It's not that easy. But that practice of seeing and believing Christ and hearing it is what, and asking God to bless it changes something in our mind.
Thank you, Father, for that image of the wheel. It's very clear. I like it. All right, two more questions to go. Will full and uninhibited reconciliation ever be completed in this life so that no one will ever have to tend to it again? Or is it a continual process that each person must pursue and be committed to in the depths of our own hearts in order to obtain?
That's an emphatic, like, it cannot be accomplished in this life. It cannot be accomplished in this life. You have to remember our theology, there's the eschaton still, and the Lord's kingdom is not, this is why, for as good intended and as well sounding as a lot of political movements are, they can be good to remedy issues, but ultimately the issue of the heart and these things, the way that it's being presented, is not possible in this life, because until the God of this world is dethroned, we will always have enmity. You could make everyone the same color today, and they'll start fighting over the color of their eyes. You can make everyone have the same color eyes, and they'll start fighting over the type of shoes they're wearing. It is part of the fallen nature, and it's one of the reasons why the Kileastic heresy is something that, you know, we reject. You cannot have a utopia here because Christ has not established his kingdom. And so we walk a razor's edge of, you can't fall into this despondency and this apathy of like, well, it doesn't matter. I'm just gonna hole up with people who are like me because it makes me comfortable, because you'll lose your soul. But on the other hand, don't try to make utopia, because then you end up being like Mussolini and Stalin and Pol Pot, because that's what they tried to do, right? What we're trying to do is bring ourselves into reconciliation with God, and then maybe we can bring others into reconciliation with ourselves and with God.
Well, if you'll indulge me, especially if I've told you the story before, or I thought it would be relevant, but I had a very powerful dream one night. I dreamt I was out in the country by myself, and suddenly the earth started shaking, and I thought, oh my goodness, it shook more and more. I was on the ground, and I thought, I'm out here all alone, and everything is shaking apart, and I could barely stand, everything's vibrating. And then I felt other hands around, and so I grabbed them, and we all could have grabbed hands, and my mind was so, the only prayer I could think of was the Lord's Prayer. I started saying the Our Father, and it shook more and more intense. I thought, I'm going to shake apart soon. Suddenly it stopped, and I stood up and looked around, and everything was gone. There was nothing but mud. I mean, everything had been destroyed. But suddenly people started emerging from the mud, and they were like covered with mud, but they were just laughing, you know. It was like, and everyone was so happy. And suddenly I realized, you know what's different? There's no fear. Mm. There's absolutely no barrier between any of this, because the worst has happened, you know. And all the bad, all the fear, it's all gone. So there's nothing left. Mm. There's mud. And I thought, but that's okay. Nobody said it. We looked at each other, we thought, oh, we can build any kind of world we want, because there's no more evil. There's no more fear. There's no more barriers between people. Of course, there was, you know, everything was gone. It was like, you know, I remembered later, I said, oh my, that's how everything started, you know. But anyway, it was, on many levels, it was very helpful to me. But yes, that's when we'll have perfect reconciliation, when there's absolutely nothing to fight about, and no separation between people, and that it's not going to happen in our presently constituted world. But we are called to be emissaries of the kingdom, mm-hmm. and to start living by the laws of the kingdom, even though it's not here yet. You know, that's why I say that church is an icon of the kingdom of God, and that's not just because we have beautiful icons of saints, and in our enactment of the sacraments is, you know, we're trying to approximate the heavenly worship,
it's also because we are living, attempting to live the laws of the kingdom, which were the commandments that Christ gave on the Mount, you know, the Beatitudes. These are the new commandments of the new kingdom. Now, of course, we often fail at it, but it's not just for our own salvation, it's for the hope of the world, that they at least start to get a picture of what life could be. Okay, I have to stop or else you won't come tomorrow because you already had your sermon.
Father, you referenced the laws of the kingdom, and one of the things that always resonated me about Father Thomas Hopko back, you know, years ago when I was listening to him, you know, a whole bunch, when he was referencing the laws of the kingdom, and he said, you know, the law of the kingdom is the law of love, and it was that law that I just felt so fully within the teaching and kind of the Orthodox Church. And I just think that you know, even our Lord, you know, he says, you know, the law is to love the Lord God with all your heart and your neighbor as yourself. And so, we're able.
I just want to say, I think one of the things that's important to realize, and for a lot of people who are interested in Orthodoxy, are coming to Orthodoxy, and when you're having conversations with people who are interested in Orthodoxy, they have to understand, you have to make something very clear to them. You have to make clear to them that we are not talking about a metaphor or a symbol when we talk about the church. I think a lot of people don't understand that. You have to get them to understand that the liturgy isn't just a bunch of people kind of standing around going through the motions. Even if everyone there is, all it takes is that one person to be in the liturgy, and the liturgy is the liturgy. Like, we are touching heaven at that moment, not in a figure of speech. A lot of people don't really realize that. This is why the sacraments and our understanding of theosis are important, because when you read the lives of the saints, when you read about the contemporary elders, what do you see? Like Father Jerome said, even animals were different around them. A lot of us have not really had the experience of being around holy people. I've had very few, but I will tell you, the few holy men and women I have been around, it's palpable. It's different. It's different. They don't even have to say anything. That's the kingdom of heaven. I'm kind of a sci-fi geek, so I'm going to use a sci-fi example, but it's like when people enter into holiness, it becomes a portal. It's like gravity. It attracts you and you feel it and you can tell that something is different. It's ineffable. You can't always explain it, but you know it's there. Once you've felt it, you felt it. And that's what you need to encourage people in, because Orthodoxy is not fast food. You can't. Sometimes God gives someone a lightning bolt of grace and they get it, but for most of us, it takes sitting and soaking. It takes learning to pray and learning to be still and quiet, which is what the liturgy teaches us, right? And when you're able to do those things, your sensitivity grows and you start to be able to get those little quick flashes of heaven. Do you know what I mean? If you have that moment where maybe you're in front of one of your favorite icons, or there's a point in the liturgy or right after communion and you can't explain it, but you're like, ah, that's God. Right? We need to remind people that's what we're doing. We're not doing head exercise.
Yeah.
Right? We're connecting with heaven.
Yeah. I've heard people talk about, you know, when they encounter, like, you know, very holy people, that there's kind of like a weight to it. You know, kind of like the weight of love, the weight of humility, and it kind of makes me think.
Gravity,
yeah.
It's gravity.
It's tangible. You can feel. You can experience it, and it makes me think of C.S. Lewis's title of one of his books, "The Weight of Glory." I think that, you know, that was, you know, something that he was pointing to in the title of that book. I know you referenced, Father Deacon, the lives of contemporary elders in your talk today, but are there any other resources that you can point us to for further learning?
I know we're not all rich and all, but I really recommend pilgrimages. Because you go to a monastery, there's many wonderful monasteries in the country, and you stay for a few days, and you soak in so much. And you contact things that you don't contact normally in your everyday life. Even though we do have the grace of communion, which is very powerful, when you go to a place where people are dedicated to prayer and living a righteous life, that opens your eyes and your sensitivities open up. And there are wonderful things that go on. And I've had so many profound experiences going traveling. I'll share one story that, because of being here, I think of Father Jacob a lot when I'm here, but I went to Mount Athos, and on the last day before I left, I managed to go up to Saluti, which had the monastery of St. John the Theologian, where the relics of St. Arsenius were. And to make a long short story short, we got there. The gates were locked, but somehow, through the grace of God, we were invited up and venerated the relics. And then we were looking for somebody to talk to about getting oil. I had a person that I baptized, Arsenius. And one of the nuns told me, "You wait here, or I get English nun." And so I went to the, over there, it was a grave. And there was no other graves. It wasn't like a cemetery, it was just one grave. And I knelt down and I prayed. Oh, I knelt down, first looked at the sign to see who it was, and it was Elder Paisius Canoe. St. Paisius now. So I said, wow. And so I began to pray. I was so delighted because I know, you know, I've read a lot, and I thought, wow, I'm right here with his relics. And after a few moments praying, I felt hands on my shoulders. I figured that Kevin, who had been my host, had come back and tell me what the nuns do. So, yes, and there was nobody behind me. And his hands were still there. And so I prayed, and then I can't describe what happened. It's beyond mine, it's ineffable, but I communed with Elder Paisius to the point that when Kevin finally came, I stood up and turned around to say, well, I've got to go now, and realized that I hadn't seen him, and it was a shock to me. Because the experience of being with him was so intense that I was shaken by it. And I afterwards, when we communed with the nun and received books and all that, I was telling Kevin, you don't understand what I'm going through. I've just had an experience that my mind can't comprehend, but I feel like I really met him. Well, I told Father Jacob the story, and he had a whole book, a whole box of the books, of the green book, Praises to Mount Athos. And so he says, I'll send you a book. And so he sent me the book, and in one of the last chapters, there are experiences at the gravesite. And it talks about people feeling his hands on him, slapping on the back, or giving the words. And then one guy says, and I had the intense feeling that I had met him personally. And I showed my wife and said, see, I wasn't imagining it. But those kind of things don't happen here. You know, I haven't had any kind of experience like that around in my home or something like that. But there are places that are holy because the life that's living there keeps the ground sacred, keeps the place sacred. And I will never forget that experience, though my mind has never comprehended how significant that was. But as an example of some of the treasures that you may encounter when you go to holy places. So I offer that as a resource, is that we have them all around us. You know, there are many places where people try to actually love God with all their hearts and mind and strength, where they try to pray every minute of the day, and they actually succeed through the grace of God and through directions from a qualified spiritual father and so forth.
I had the opportunity to go to St. Eton's Monastery and Seminary the first week of Lent this year. I spent about 4 days just kind of soaking in the services and kind of talking with the monks and the seminarians, and oh my gosh, it was such a wonderful and enriching experience. You know, I left there and I was like, this is why people go on pilgrimages. I, you know, I need to do more of this stuff. Yeah.
Not to toot the horn of the Brotherhood of St. Moses the Black, but many people find similar uplifting, nourishing experiences just coming to a conference. And I'm just saying because I hear it expressed a lot. They come, they feel nourished, they feel lifted up, they feel supercharged, so to speak. And glory be to God, Father Moses, Father Paisis, and I have marveled in it every year since the first year, you know, that something happened that was way beyond us. It almost had nothing to do with us, but it's something that happens there. And so there are many things, you know, that if you're hungry for it, God will open those doors.
Tell folks where that's going to be, where and when that's going to be this year.
It's going to be in Indianapolis at the Joy of All Who Sorrow Church on, and I'll probably be sending a flyer here or something like that, but it will be the 7th, 8th, and 9th of October.
So I appreciate your answer to that question, because whenever I think of resources, I immediately think of books, avenue for continued learning. So thank you for that answer.
Anybody else? Any along the line of books? Any books? Any particular saints that anyone can draw us to in order to do continued learning on this topic?
Yeah, I think I have seen in my own life and the lives of some women that I know, some mothers, and some people who maybe aren't necessarily as erudite, if you will. Elder Porphyrius, St. Porphyrius now, starting off with Wounded by Love, that is an incredible book. And it's interesting because when you read through part of his life, it doesn't strike you as anything incredibly profound at first, but there is just this sense of the grace of God and the peace that God had given him when you read that book. It's very unique in that, and St. Porphyrius was profound because he was able to really kind of mine the depths, I mean, being on Athos, and then making things so simple. He made things really simple. So Elder Porphyrius, I recommend St. Theophan the Recluse to anyone. St. Theophan the Recluse is profound because he's at the end of, right before the revolution in Russia, he's at this kind of like the beginning of, you know, that kind of scientific push that has shaped really the modern world. And yet he's not scared to acknowledge, you know, science and things like that. In other words, he's familiar in a modern sense to us. He's accessible in a lot of ways. And St. Theophan really kind of encapsulates that Slavic tradition of being able to, like, this is how you do it, boom, 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 you know? And he lays it out very simply, and I think if you kind of start off with St. Theophan, then you're able to move on to people like Elder Sophroni, St. Siloam, because now he's given you, if that's how God leads you through books, St. Theophan gives you the kind of rubric of how to live out your day-to-day orthodoxy, so that when you approach someone profound like Siloam and Sophroni, you're like, okay, you know, it's not just going to always be floating up in your head.
All available at the St. John the Wonderworker bookstore.
All right, so with that, thank you so very much for spending some time answering these questions.
We have gone long through this wonderful dialogue. Thank you, guys. So actually, the formal question and answer period right now, we are going to go ahead and say we're not going to do that so that you can get on with the rest of your Saturday. We have a couple more things we have to do here today, but I'm sure these guys will be around for a little while if you want to talk with them and ask any questions. And certainly, as I said earlier, this conversation is just beginning, really. This is something we hope to keep doing in person, but also email, you can Facebook, you can do whatever. We encourage you just to be in contact with these guys and each other, having these important conversations. So with that said, we are going to be closing our time with prayer today, upstairs in the nave, and it will be the Octopus St. Moses.
It'll be the
Arcane.
Regulation Reconciliation.
Oh, okay, even better. All right. Why don't we go ahead and make our way upstairs in just a moment. If you need a few minutes to use the restroom, make a phone call, or whatever, you want to do that. you upstairs. Thank you so much for coming.